Finally, the pancreas. The pancreas is our third example of an accessory organ we're going to take a look at. Pancreas, this will be a little bit of review for you here. We've mentioned the pancreas before in the context of the endocrine system. The endocrine system, when we were going through that, we talked about insulin. So the pancreas, just by way of a little bit of review, it has both endocrine and exocrine functions. The endocrine function is to make insulin and glucagon. That's done by the islets, islets of Langerhans. The exocrine function is what we're going to be focused on here. The exocrine function is that the pancreas produces digestive enzymes, and those get secreted as pancreatic juice. This is exocrine, meaning there is a duct that carries it out to some specific location, rather than just secreting into the bloodstream. So what we've got here are the acinar cells. These are producing the pancreatic juice. They produce enzymes that are in an inactive form. They're called zymogens. These are enzymes that are not yet active. And then another thing that is in the secretions is bicarbonate. Think about this one for a minute. Why would bicarbonate be an important thing to produce? Well, the stomach, right? We said that the stomach is extremely acidic. The stomach produces HCl. Once the contents of the stomach, the chyme, once it leaves the stomach, there has to be a way to neutralize that acid. And the pancreas is in large part responsible for that. So this bicarbonate, this is going to help to bring the pH back up so that the chyme is no longer so acidic. So two key things. Pancreatic juice has bicarbonate, and it's also got a whole bunch of digestive enzymes. How do those enzymes get activated? We've said they're produced in an inactive form. This is going to bring us back to the brush border of the small intestine. So these zymogens that are produced, when they enter the small intestine, the brush border enzymes will activate them. The brush border enzymes will cleave some of the little constituents off of these inactive enzymes, and then they'll be in an active form. So this is an amazing control mechanism. This is really important. If the enzymes that were produced were in an active state, then that could be a problem for the pancreas. The pancreas might start to digest itself. So really, really neat control mechanism there. Inactive enzymes get secreted into the small intestine, and then they become activated by the brush border enzymes. Here's a picture of the layout of these three accessory organs, these two accessory organs, the pancreas and the gallbladder. The liver would be up above here. It's not shown in this picture. The bile duct and also the pancreas, its duct, they both feed into the small intestine, and specifically into the duodenum. This is in the very early section of the small intestine. And we know what happens from there. If not, you can go back and review the video about the small intestine. But then all of those will help with, all of those secretions will help with digestion in the small intestine. And then later on in the small intestine, some of these substances will be taken back up, like the bile salts. They'll be reabsorbed and routed back to the liver and get recycled. So that's what we're gonna cover for the digestive system. There are some more slides here at the end. If you're watching this video, you get this heads up. I'm not gonna test you on this. This is mostly here for informational purposes. If anybody is interested, more information about digestion and absorption of specific types of biomolecules, carbs, lipids, and proteins. If you're wondering, we didn't say anything about nucleic acids in this chapter. They do get digested too. And in fact, some of that seems to start in the stomach. But that's something we didn't focus on. Our book doesn't focus on it either. So that's going to be it as far as what I'll test you on. Again, I won't be testing you on these last few slides, this one, or this one. These are here for informational purposes.